Hi everyone, Danny here on this rainy evening to talk to you about the book Verbal Judo. Verbal Judo is a book that came out of a program that was developed for the police department. It was developed for police officers to help them when they're in a situation, when they're dealing with someone who is being uncooperative and downright combative. It's a program to help them remain calm, to remain polite. It is a program designed to help them to get that person to calm down and to comply with what the police officer wants. And in that original format, I like the book. If you have a job like the police, where you regularly deal with people who hate you, who don't trust you, who you absolutely have to get to cooperate with you, they will either cooperate willingly or you will throw them to the ground and throw cuffs on them and force them to cooperate. This is an excellent book. It will help to avoid a lot of those throw them to the ground situations. Now the book has been retooled, revamped, rebranded, and is being sold as a communication book for everyday life, a communication book for hearth and home. I think it fails. I think it absolutely, utterly fails in that sense. There are components of the book which would be beneficial to use at home, but they are all very basic building blocks of communication. They have been talked about in 100 other communication books, 100 other leadership books. And my opinion, a good leadership book has to also be a good communication book. A good communication book is also a good leadership book, because you cannot be a good leader if you cannot communicate with the people you are trying to lead. Well, like I was saying, he talks about empathy. Okay, empathy's in every communication book I've ever listened to, every leadership book I've ever listened to, every good one at least. He talks about paraphrasing. Paraphrasing has been around forever. If you don't know what paraphrasing is a tool to use both to make the person feel like you're trying to understand them and also to actually understand the person. If used correctly, basically you're having, say, a discussion with your wife, a disagreement with your wife, and she says something, rather than assuming, okay, she's just calling me a no good lazy slob, you paraphrase back. And then you don't paraphrase back, oh, so if I understand correctly, you think I'm a no good lazy slob? No. You paraphrase back, okay, I want to make sure I understand. If I've got it correct, you're upset about this, this, and this. It works if your goal is actually to understand the other person's point of view. If your goal is just to, if I'm understanding you correctly, you're saying, you know, to kind of, let's see, you're wrong, you're stupid. It doesn't work at all. But that's beside the point. That's in a bunch of other books. There's over half this book that not only do I think would not be useful at home, I actually think would be harmful in the house. I would never, ever use it. Might offend you with what I'm about to say. So sorry. Now I'm actually not sorry at all. But I am the leader in my house. I am solely responsible for the health, happiness, and welfare of my family. That's how I view my role. That's who I view myself as. Now, verbal judo teaches you how to handle every conversation in such a way as to get the other person to calm down and do what you want them to do. So, if every time my wife and I have a disagreement, I get her to calm down and do exactly what I want her to do, am I being an effective leader? Am I being an effective communicator? No. We have a joke in my house. Me and the kids, we love this joke. I've said it forever, you know. Dad may not always be right, but he's never wrong. They know it's a joke because they are well aware of how often I am wrong. I personally happen to believe that I am of above average intelligence. Guess what? So do you. So does 99% of the people on Earth. Guess what else? It is a mathematical impossibility for 99% of the people on Earth to be of above average intelligence. That means that half the people who believe that they are of above average intelligence are deceiving themselves. Now, do they know they're deceiving themselves? No, I don't think so, because the whole definition of self-deception is you've deceived yourself. You are unaware of what you don't know. You think you're right when really you're wrong. So, what if I'm deceived? What if I'm of below average intelligence? What if I'm lucky to be correct 25% of the time? And yet 100% of the time, I handle my disagreements in such a way as to gain compliance from the people that I'm in conflict with. What if 100% of the time I'm right and we do things my way? Am I being a good leader? Am I being an effective, good husband and father and friend? Nope. I don't think so. So, in my communication with my family, in my communication with coworkers, is my goal to win 100% of the time? Is my goal to get them to do what I want them to do because I want them to do it? No. And approaching any conversation with family and friends with that goal in mind is a recipe for disaster 100% of the time. He carries it even further than that in the book. Basically, it's a do whatever it takes to get your way, short of resorting to violence. He recommends deceiving people. And he gives examples when deception was needed, when deception saved the day. An example he gives is of a man who had gone a little off the rocker and had a knife to his son's throat, threatened to slice his son's throat, because he believed that his wife had put demons in his son. And he needed to free his son from the demons by slicing his throat. In talking to the man, he convinced the man that he knew a priest who owed him several favors and would come rushing down there to cast the demons out of his son, saving the man from having to kill his son and giving him victory over his hateful wife. He freely admits he didn't know any such priest. He had no intention of calling a priest. It was all a deception. It worked. The man put the knife down. They got the man the help he needed. They got the son the help he needed, because I guarantee you at that point in time, that son needs some counseling. Great. I don't disagree with the use of deception in that situation. If there's a crazy man that's got a knife to my throat, if there's a crazy man that's got a knife to the throat of anyone, and the only way to separate knife from throat is to deceive the knife wielder, deception away. Have at it. That is a situation where I fully support the use of deception. In dealings with my family, in dealings with my friends, with my coworkers, there is not a situation in which I condone deception. Deception will be detrimental to my relationships with my family, with my friends, 100% of the time. My family, my friends, my coworkers, they are not morons. They will figure out that I have deceived them. They will learn, hey, guess what? Dad has taken deception and added it to his communication toolbox. Don't trust Dad. Once bitten, twice shy, as the old rock and roll song goes, right? So if I use that, I'm actually harming my communication with them. Another example where the goal in your communication, see, this is the problem I have with this book. I don't have the problem with the techniques. Every technique he lists in this book, I think there is a situation in which someone dealing with strangers in a contentious, potentially violent and disastrous situation could and should use that. But if you use it for all of your communication, then you lose the purpose behind communication. And this last example, it will be a good example of that. So he gives the example of a father asking his son to take out the trash. And his teenage son acts like teenage sons everywhere act then. It's not teenage sons, teenagers. Gender doesn't matter. I've acted this way. Whether you want to admit it, you've acted this way. If you've raised teenagers, your teenagers have acted this way at some point in time in their life. Some continue the behavior, some move right past it. But his son does the old, oh, why are you picking on me? Everybody picks on me. Nobody loves me. Everybody hates me. Think I'll go eat worms. Right? All teenagers do that at some point in time. Now the normal parental reaction is, I am your father. I told you to take out that trash. You will take out that trash, or I will take you out. I brought you into this world, and I can take you out of it. He recommends you don't do that. I recommend you don't do that. That is a terrible way to handle your children. His recommendation at this point, so far, I agree with. His recommendation is to treat your children the way you would want to be treated if you were behaving as childish as your child was. And if you were behaving as childish as your child, and we all, I'm 48 years old, there's times when I behave childish. I'm only willing to admit that in a video. I'm not willing to admit that in person. So if you come up and you say, hey, you said in the video, I'll deny it. No, I'm too mature, I'm too good for that. But we all at times act immature and childish. But in those times, you would want the person to still treat you with respect. You would want the person to give you an opportunity to change your behavior, to step up to the plate, and to show some maturity. And he recommends, and I recommend, that you do that with your child as well. He suggests some words for the father to use. The words he suggests are, hey, son, you remember a couple of months ago we were setting up your allowance, and we agreed that you would be responsible for taking out the trash as part of your allowance. Now, the words might not work for you. If you don't have your kids on an allowance, you'd have to come up with different word choice, but the idea is the same. You give your child a chance to, you know, realize, hey, I'm being immature without calling them immature. Step up and do the adult thing, you know. And yeah, he goes on to say that, hey, if your child then takes out the trash, great, you've won. You got your child to take out the trash. I would say if your child then takes out the trash, great, you've won, not because you got the trash taken out, but because you were able to deal with your child in a mature adult fashion. It's a difference in goals. And this is really where, in my opinion, he goes off the rails. Because if your son's response then is, well, Dad, you know, I've been meaning to talk to you about this allowance thing. I don't think you pay me nearly enough for what the job is worth. Therefore, I'm not going to do it anymore. Now, his recommendation, and if your only goal is to get the trash out to the curb, great, follow his recommendation. His recommendation is to tell your son, you know, hey, son of mine, if you'll remember back to when we had this conversation, you know, the agreement was that you would be responsible for getting the trash to the curb. Not that you would take it out yourself. I don't care if you get your little sister to do it. I don't care if you get your mom to do it. You just have to be responsible for making sure that trash has gotten out to the curb, and you've done your job. The child then goes off, gets mom to take the trash out. You've won, trash is out at the curb. You just lost. You just lost because you just taught your son a horrible, horrible life lesson. Real life doesn't work that way. Let's take this out into the real world, huh? So I own a restaurant. I hire that kid. I hire that kid to be a waiter. I give him a section of tables. I say, you are responsible for the people who sit at these tables. Now, he's learned from dad, I'm responsible means that all I've got to do is get someone else to do my job for me, and I've done my job. So, he notices that, ooh, that's one really good-looking hostess over there. I wonder if I can get her number, get a date next Friday night. Oh, I need someone to take care of these tables for me. Hey, you busser. Come here, busser. So, listen, now, I know you don't want to be bussing tables forever, do you? Oh, no. I want to become a waiter like you. All right, sweet. Here's what I'm going to do for you, because I like you. You seem to me like a smart guy, just needs a little boost in the world, and I'm going to give you that boost. I'm going to put you in charge of my tables. I'm going to go stand over there. I'm going to look like I'm talking to the hostess, but I'm actually going to be watching you to make sure that you're doing it correctly. You have full responsibility for the tables. It will give you an opportunity to learn. It will give you an opportunity to build your skills. It will give you an opportunity to show the owner what you're made of. Okay, go, yeah, you go. And he goes, busser goes off to the tables. Boy goes off to hit on the hostess. Now, I, the owner, I've been back in the back. I've been making sure my kitchen's all straight. My cooks are all in order. My temps are all good. I managed restaurants before, so I know a bit about this. I come out. Look at that. My new server is over there talking to my hostess, distracting her from doing her job, which is to keep the hostess station clean, greet and seat as people come in. The busser is completely ignoring his job, which is to help all of the servers to do a better job with their serving by bussing their tables, because he's taking care of that waiter's tables. Not only is that waiter not contributing to my restaurant, he is a drain on my staff. How's that going to work out for that boy? Take that out into any job. We've all had those people that don't do their job. They expect other people to do their jobs for them. We've got a name for those people where I come from. It's not a name I ever want used for me. It's not a name I ever want used for any of my sons. But that's the lesson that dad just taught his kid. And that's the problem with this book. Because the problem with this book is it assumes the purpose of communication is for me to get my way. Now, when I originally went up to my son and said, hey, son, would you take out the trash? The goal of that communication was to get the trash out to the curb. I agree. But the instant my son went, nobody loves me, everybody hates me, think I'll go eat worms, my goal changed. I no longer care about getting the trash out to the curb. I now care about helping my son to grow into a happy, healthy, productive member of society. Someone who can support himself. Someone who can hold up his head with pride. Someone who will do a good job. That's going to change how I communicate with my son. I mean, for pity's sake, if my son says to me, Dad, I don't think that the agreement we originally made on how much I was going to get paid to take out the trash is worth the job. I'm not doing it. Hopefully, my prior conversations and my relationship with my son is one where he trusts me, where he knows that I actually have his best intent, that my intentions are to do what's best for him. So that when I then say to him, hey, son of mine, I love you very much. And if I'm understanding you correctly, which he doesn't even do this in the book, he talks about paraphrasing a little bit, but then in his examples, he never paraphrases. When his son says, Dad, the job ain't worth it, he doesn't paraphrase. Well, son, I would paraphrase. I would say, if I'm understanding you correctly, you're unhappy with our original negotiation. You're feeling like it's not fair that you only get paid so much and are required to do so much. Is that correct? Well, yeah, Dad, that's true. Okay. Well, hopefully you know that I love you and I have, what's best for you in mind here. You're going to run into this situation in life, sons of mine. You're going to hit times where you just you feel like your boss is taking advantage of you. You feel like, and maybe you're right. Maybe you are being taken advantage of. Maybe you're not being paid what the job is worth. But here's a reality of the world we live in. Your boss is not going to pay you what you're worth. Your boss is going to pay you the minimum required to replace you. If you half-ass a job, he can replace you with anyone. He doesn't have to pay you that much. The better way to handle situations like that is to attack the job with gusto. Hey, I'm going to take the trash out to the curb. I'm going to clean out the garbage can. I'm going to clean out the space where the garbage can sits. I'm going to make sure that I keep all of that clean and nice and fresh smelling and do a better job of it than anyone has ever done. That way, Dad will recognize my value and up my pay. Or if he doesn't recognize my value and up my pay, I can come to him later and say, hey, Dad, I feel like I've earned more. Can we do some sit down and renegotiate in a respectful way? I mean, let me ask you, son of mine. If you owned a construction company, you hired a framer to frame a house. He got halfway through, came up to you and said, I don't think this job is worth what you're paying me. I ain't going to finish unless you pay me more. What's your opinion of that guy going to be? Do you respect his manhood? Do you think, wow, what a mature, grown adult guy. I'm really glad I hired this guy. What was your opinion? Yeah, hit the road, buddy. I can replace you tomorrow, right? But what if that framer shows up to work on time or early? Outworks everybody. His job is just, you've never seen framing like this done. And as quickly as this. And then a little bit later, he comes to you and says, you know, hey, I'm sorry, I'm going to have to turn in my 2 weeks' notice. I got a better offer elsewhere. Now what's your reaction going to be? Hold on a second. I love this guy. I've never had a framer like this guy. I need to keep this guy. Let's talk. What's this better offer? Can I, you know, is there something I can do to keep you around? So you see, son, in this situation, I understand you want more money. I understand you don't feel the job is worth it. Hopefully you can understand that you did not handle this correctly and we can move forward, you know. If you're wanting a good communication book, an absolute favorite of mine is Crucial Conversations. I don't remember who it's by. I'm going to go ahead and put it back in my library, re-listen to it. I'll do that immediately. And then I will do another review on that book and do a little contrast and comparison between the two books here. If you have a job where you're a police officer, you know, you're in those situations where someone's got a knife to someone's throat, where you've got to get a drunk to step out of a car and cooperate, Verbal Judo is a great book for those purposes. If you're just someone who wants to be a better spouse, better parent, a better friend, a better boss, a better leader, I do not recommend this book. Avoid this book. It has its purpose, it has its place, but that purpose and that place, in my opinion, is very narrow. Now, I hope you all have a really good day, and I will talk to you later.